Good evening and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. I'm Jonathan Curiel, San Francisco journalist and author of All America, and your moderator for today. Find the Commonwealth Club on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Aaron David Miller, Middle East analyst and negotiator and author of the book, The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. Aaron David Miller became a public policy fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International School for Scholars in 2006, where he wrote his fourth book, The Much Too Promised Land. His other books include The Arab States and the Palestine Question, Between Ideology and Self-Interest, The PLO and the Politics of Survival, and The Search for Security, Saudi Arabian Oil, and American Foreign Policy. For the previous two decades, he served at the Department of State as an advisor to six secretaries of state, where he helped formulate U.S. policy on the Middle East and the Arab-Israel peace process, most recently as a senior advisor for Arab-Israeli negotiations. He also served as the Deputy Special Middle East Coordinator for Arab-Israeli Negotiations, senior member of the State Department's Policy Planning Staff in the Bureau of Intelligence and Research, and in the Office of the Historian. He has received the department's Distinguished Superior and Meritorious Honor Awards. Mr. Miller received his PhD in American Diplomatic and Middle East History from the University of Michigan in 1977 and joined the State Department the following year. During 1982 and 1983, he was a Council on Foreign Relations Fellow and a resident scholar at the Georgetown Center for Strategic and International Studies. In 1984, he served a temporary tour at the American Embassy in Amman, Jordan, and between 1998 and 2000, Mr. Miller served on the United States Holocaust Memorial Council. After leaving the State Department, Mr. Miller served as president of Seeds of Peace from January 2003 until January 2006. Seeds of Peace is a nonprofit organization dedicated to empowering young leaders from regions in conflict and the leadership skills required, with the leadership skills required to advance reconciliation and coexistence. His media and speaking appearances include CNN, The NewsHour with Jim Lehrer, Fox News, the NBC Nightly News, CBS Evening News, National Public Radio, the BBC, Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, Al Arabiya, and Al Jazeera. Mr. Miller has been a featured presenter at the World Economic Forum in Davos in Amman, Harvard University, Columbia University, New York University, University of California, Berkeley, the City Club of Cleveland, Chatham House, and the International Institute for Strategic Studies. His articles have appeared in newspapers including the New York Times, the Washington Post, Los Angeles Times, and the International Herald Tribune. Mr. Miller will be the study leader for the Commonwealth Club's World Leaders Travel Program to Israel and the Palestinian territories next May. He will be joined by several distinguished guest speakers throughout the trip with discussions moderated by ABC News veteran Sam Donaldson. Please welcome Aaron David Miller.
Thanks, Jonathan. Jonathan, thank you very much. It's an honor and privilege for me to be here, and it's wonderful to get out of Washington. You don't know how lucky you are. You live in a beautiful city with its own rhythm and its own ebb and flow, and every time I come to San Francisco, and that isn't that often, half a dozen times, over the course of the last 10 or 12 years, I'm really struck by the magic of this place. So it's really wonderful to be here. Having just turned 60, I have come to value two things in life that I realize now are extremely important. One is honesty, and the other is clarity. There is too little of both in life. And having worked for six secretaries of state, I can assure you there's far too little of it in diplomacy. Governance should be about remedy. If it's not about remedy, then I'm not sure why men and women seek power. If it's not to benefit the common good, the commonwealth, so to speak, it strikes me that it's a waste. But remedy requires a cruel and unforgiving assessment of reality. If you're not prepared to accept the world the way it is, or at least assess the world the way it is, you'll never have a chance of reshaping it in the way of the world that you want it to be. And finding this balance between the real and the ideal seems to me is the beginning of wisdom, not just in diplomacy and foreign policy, but in life. And in that spirit of honesty and clarity, I want to make a number of observations about American foreign policy in the Middle East. I want to assure you at the beginning, because what you are going to hear may sound critical, but I am not a declinist in any way. I believe deeply in America, deeply, with all of its imperfections, and there are many. The gap that separates the way we are from what we could be is considerable. But we are the most consequential country on the face of the earth. Last November, Americans, regardless of their political party, Republican, Democrat, Independent, validated a system that is quite remarkable and elected a man, a member of a minority group, still despised by millions of his fellow citizens, his wife, a direct descendant of slaves, and elevated that man to the most powerful position on earth. No other democratic polity in the world today, not the Brits, not the French, not the Germans, not the Israelis, could ever have done what the American polity did in November. That's a validation of an extraordinary political system with all of its imperfections. And it's a reason for celebration. It's a reason to appreciate American exceptionalism. As long as it's clearly understood that American exceptionalism, the fact that we are different and unique, does not mean that we have the power, the capacity, or the right to impose our exceptionalism or our uniqueness on the rest of the world. My trope today is of an America like a modern-day Gulliver, wandering around in a part of the world that we only understand too late, tied up by tiny tribes whose interests sometimes are not our own. And when they're not tying us up, we're tied up into knots by our own politics, and more important, by our own illusions. The notion that America has dominated this region is an illusion. We've had much more success in Europe and in Asia, but not in the Middle East. Not in this angry, dysfunctional, broken region. Here we have, I would argue to you, moments of success. But the notion that America is a hegemon, a power that somehow can impose its will and its views on small tribes, who will always have a greater stake in the outcome of their struggles than we will, is an illusion. And I would even argue further that for the last 16 years, eight under Bill Clinton, for whom I worked, and eight under George W. Bush, and I worked for Colin Powell for 2 years, America has been failing. We have been failing in how to make war, preemptive, preventative war, and we have been failing in matters relating to peacemaking. And if a great power cannot prosecute wars, particularly wars of choice, and in a war of choice that you do not have to prosecute, you better have a very clear sense of what you want to do. Because the judgment and the scale for wars of choice are much higher than wars of necessity. But if a great power cannot succeed in matters of war making and cannot succeed in matters of peacemaking, then it's arguable. It's an arguable proposition whether or not that power is great. And what I have learned in life is that the most compelling ideology of all is not capitalism, it's not democracy, it's not nationalism, it's success. Success is the world's most compelling ideology. Why? Because success generates power, and success generates constituents. Failure, or lack of success, to be more charitable, breeds the opposite. And the election of Barack Obama notwithstanding, we are not as admired, respected, or from the standpoint of a great power, feared in a region that is increasingly critical to our national interests as we should be. And therein lies the problem. The solution requires cruel and unforgiving analysis. Not faith, not theology, but reason. And here I agree with Tennyson, who argued that there's more faith in honest self-doubt than there is in half the world's creeds. More faith in honest self-doubt than half the world's creeds. Asking the right questions as Americans, in my judgment now, is as important as believing that we know what the answers are. In my book, I quote from a preeminent philosopher, the late Michael Jackson, who in his wonderful song, Man in the Mirror, argued, and I won't sing it for you, but I will paraphrase it, argued that if you want to make a change in your life, there's only one place to start. Not, and that's not with blaming somebody else. You want to make a change in your life, in a friendship, in a marriage, in a business proposition, in diplomacy, then the place to start is by looking in the mirror. Americans are not good at it, but we have to be. So let me identify 10 basic propositions, lessons learned, if you will. I'm not here to sell you anything. You can accept them. You can reject them. You can turn them over in your mind and determine whether or not they make sense. My days of selling are over. But these 10 propositions, I would argue to you, will help America avoid traps and failures. They do not guarantee success in a dysfunctional and angry and conflict-ridden Middle East, but they will help us to avoid failure. Number one, which I would argue is the elemental point of departure. The international conflicts with which we are embroiled, particularly the Arab-Israeli conflict, are not conflicts based on the forces of goodness on one hand pitted against the forces of evil on the other. They're not Manichaean confrontations between light and darkness. They are terribly complex conflicts in which each party has competing needs and requirements, some more just than the others. But the conflict will not be resolved until the needs and requirements of both sides are met. Now, you could argue that this is the definition of a tragedy. In the Arab-Israeli issue, I would argue it is. Competing needs and requirements between Arabs and Israelis and Palestinians, which will somehow have to be reconciled short of 100%, because nobody in life gets 100%. Not in a business, not in a marriage, not in a friendship, and not in diplomacy. The perfect can't become the enemy of the good. Because when the perfect becomes the enemy of the good, nothing good happens. So the point of departure to me is simple. It's elemental. You can accept it, you can reject it. If you don't accept it, your alternative is to choose sides. One side has a monopoly on pain, truth, and justice. The other side doesn't. But I assure you, if you choose to choose sides, and you can, I know many people who do, and it's understandable and it's natural. People have investments, religious investments, ethnic investments, ideological investments. But if you choose sides, you abandon, in my judgment, the capacity to analyze, in this case, the Arab-Israeli issue, let alone the capacity to try to do anything about it. What you need here, in addition to sympathy, is empathy. You need to be empathic to try to the best of your capacity to understand what it's like to be the other. Empathy is a much more useful and instructive tool for diplomacy than sympathy. Second, all conflicts, and it's very difficult for Americans to understand this. I lived my life by the exact opposite rule for a quarter of a century. All conflicts do not necessarily have ends. They do not. Particularly conflicts in which men and women use God's name to justify their behavior and their actions. My friend George Mitchell argues that conflicts created by men and women can be resolved by men and women. George Mitchell believes that. He had success in Northern Ireland, less so in the Middle East. He believes it, and I respect him for that. The question is whether conflicts in which men and women invoke God's name can be resolved by men and women. I don't know the answer to that. But what I do know is that conflicts driven by religious identity, ethnic sectarianism, a sense of trauma and historical wounding. Deeply entrenched conflicts cannot be resolved by great powers who do not live in the neighborhood. Great powers can help, but these are existential conflicts from the perspective of those who wage them, and tiny powers live on the knife's edge. They have very little margin for error. It's sad that it is so. That is the way they perceive the world, but it is so from their world. And as Americans, we have a hard time understanding this. We are split the difference people. That's our software. Rational, enlightened men and women sit down, put their arguments and their cards on the table. They don't get everything they want, but the deal is made. For the enlightened benefit of the Commonwealth, the deal is made. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. But in all cases where Arab-Israeli negotiations have worked, it has been when the locals themselves owned the process by which the problems were solved. Larry Summers, who occupies a very high position in the Barack Obama administration, once said that in the history of the world, no one ever washed a rental car. Now, why is he telling me this? I'm telling you this because this is probably the most important piece of philosophical advice that you will hear tonight. No one in the history of the world washes a rental car. Of course you don't wash a rental car, because you only care about what you own. And this is a critically important issue. Arabs and Israelis, Iraqis, Afghans, Pakistanis must own the solutions. They cannot be imposed and somehow forced by outsiders, no matter how big and strong they really are. Third, I think that our split-the-difference mentality is one of our more endearing qualities. It's what makes us who we are. We, by nature, have an optimistic, idealized view of the world. And I would argue to you the reason we have that view and the reason we can be good negotiators when we don't allow our romantic notions and sentimentality with respect to peacemaking to get the better of us is precisely because we are detached. We alone among the great powers of the world have achieved a degree of physical security unprecedented in human history. Think about it. If you were to ask me what one fact explains American behavior abroad, no matter what conflict we're talking about, I would respond as follows. The departure point for understanding America's policy toward the rest of the world is simply this. We have non-predatory neighbors to our north and to our south, Canadians and the Mexicans, and we have fish to our east and to our west. Literally, what one historian called our liquid assets. This fact, which no other consequential power in history has ever had, explains, in my view, everything. It explains our optimism, the notion that we think the world can be made a better place. It explains our idealism. It explains our practicality and pragmatism. It explains our arrogance when we somehow believe that we have the solutions that American exceptionalism can somehow be exported. This notion is endearing, and yet it can be dangerous because it leads to a failure to appreciate what it's like for the tiny tribe, whether it's Iraq, Afghanistan, the Arab-Israeli issue, Lebanon, it doesn't matter. People in these conflicts are not like us. We persist in somehow believing that they are. Their histories, their sense of reality diverge from ours. One example, day 8 of the Camp David summit, July 2000. We are there. The summit has already failed. It would last another 4 days, but it's basically over. And the issue on the table is Jerusalem. Jerusalem. And there the Israelis and the Palestinians, Yasser Arafat and Ehud Barak, are asserting sovereignty over one piece of Jerusalem, 35 square acre noble enclosure, the Haram HaSharif, the noble enclosure, on which sits two mosques holy to Islam, and below sit the two Jewish temples. Both sides are asserting sovereignty to what they believe, or what we judge to be, overlapping sacred space. That's what it is up there. It's overlapping sacred space. Both sides asserting sovereignty. Well, what do the Americans do? The Americans react as Americans. They work out, or try to work out, split the difference solutions. First, we tried sovereignty above ground to the Palestinians and sovereignty below ground to the Israelis. What could possibly be wrong with that? Think about it. What's wrong with that? Well, that was rejected almost immediately. Then we went to taking sovereignty away from both sides and repositing sovereignty where it belonged. Where does sovereignty overlapping sacred space belong? It belongs with God. Well, that was, frankly, a silly idea, and that was rejected. It was rejected because from the standpoint of the Israelis and the Palestinians, Jerusalem is not to be shared. It's not to be cut up like a piece of salami. It's to be possessed. Possessed in the name of God, possessed in the name of the tribe, possessed in the name of the nation. That's what history teaches us, sadly, about Jerusalem and its Abrahamic tradition, where Islam and Judaism and Christianity coexist with principles that are common to each. This is a nice thought, but it's not real. It's not real. And we have to, without abandoning hope that the problem of Jerusalem can be resolved, we have to abandon our illusions. Four, leadership. If there was one factor above all that is critically important, it's that. Without leadership in this region, whether it's Afghanistan, Pakistan, the Arab-Israeli issue, Iraq, bad things are likely to happen. And sadly, the era of heroic leadership, at least in the Arab-Israeli issue, is over. We have politicians who are prisoners of their constituents, not masters of them. The Begins, the Sadats, the King Husseins, the Rabins, even the Arafats in his first incarnation are gone. And in their place, well-meaning, well-intentioned politicians who don't have the legitimacy and the moral authority to make the kinds of decisions that are required to lead their respective publics to a better place. The costs of making these decisions are existential. Anwar Sadat, Yitzhak Rabin, I watched at Camp David when Arafat and Barak sat in the very cabin that Begin and Sadat sat in when Jimmy Carter brought them together in September of 78. And I thought, what is Arafat thinking? He's thinking about Sadat. He's thinking that Sadat got 100% of Sinai in the dismantling of all Jewish settlements there, and yet Sadat was murdered. And what is Barak thinking? Is Barak thinking about Rabin? Killed by a fellow Jew in November 1995, which effectively brought the Oslo process and any partnership with the Palestinians to an end. Leadership is critical. Do not ever let anybody tell you that the world is composed of impersonal forces over which men and women have no control. It's a myth. The history of the mid-20th century is defined by six men. The pain, the suffering, the hope of redemption, peace and prosperity, Hitler, Stalin, Churchill, Roosevelt, Mao Zedong, throw in Lenin and Einstein. Think about that. Think about the power of individuals to affect the course of history for good or for ill. Leadership is critical. Without it, we have nothing. There's a wonderful line from Henry IV, part one, in which one character says to the other, "You know, I can summon up the spirits from the vasty deep." And the other character replies, "But so can any man. The question is, when you call them, do they come?" That's the question. Leadership. Do they come when you call them? Five, look to the past. do not ignore history. I could count on one hand, I'm a trained historian, the number of times that I argued in front of a Secretary of State or a President using history to either constrain or impel a decision maker to do something. Do you know what a travesty that is? Faulkner, who knew nothing about the Arab-Israeli conflict, wrote in Requiem for a Nun that the past is never over. It's never even past. Faulkner was right. And while history doesn't repeat, that's not why you study history. Great powers study history because it's a hedge against the two things a great power, in this case the United States, has to be constantly aware of: its own omnipotence, a feeling that it is all powerful, and its own omniscience, the notion that it knows everything. Look only to Iraq for how history was ignored. If I were to ask you how many Americans were killed, we occupied Japan from 1945 to 1952. Do you know how many Americans were killed on the Japanese mainland in hostile actions by Japanese during 7 years of American occupation of Japan? Zero. Not one American was killed. So, what do you suppose we were thinking when we decided, in a war of discretion and choice, to invade and occupy a country roughly population-wise the size of the state of California, rip off its authoritarian head, depose and help the Iraqis execute its cruel and evil leader without sufficient understanding of the politics or sufficient force? And people say to me, but it's not so bad, it's getting better. But you see, that's never the question. It's not, can America do anything? It's, what does it cost to do it? That's the key with every decision that has to be made. I'm on a plane from Dallas to Tucson last week, and a young man gets on in an airline-supplied wheelchair, pushed by his wife, military haircut. He has no legs. I'm sitting in first class, and he is in the back. And an hour into the flight, I'm on the aisle, and I hear something to my left. And here he comes, dragging himself on the floor with his wife following him to the bathroom. And it took me 30 minutes to recompose myself. Because I'm asking myself, this is part of the cost. The question is not, can America do something? It's always, what will it cost? And I raise this question for obvious reasons. Because of the president's recent decision with respect to Afghanistan. More on this in a minute. Look to the past. Six. We're in an investment trap, in my judgment, in many of these situations and areas. We can't run away from it, and we can't fix it. And for a great power, spending the blood of its men and women and its treasure, it's a very, very, very bad place to be. And I can't fix this. I don't have an answer to this. I listened to the president's speech. I don't have an answer. He has no choice. He is in an investment trap. And I don't know how he's going to get out of it. It's not Vietnam. Fair enough. It's not. But there will be cost. And with a $1.2 trillion deficit, nation building in America is really important now more than ever. I think we're running out of time. Let me summarize a few other points with respect to problems. Afghanistan, I think we have a serious problem. The president is right to identify that we have a national interest there. 9/11 was the second bloodiest day in American history, exceeded only by one day in the Battle of Antietam, September 17, 1862. When more Americans were killed in a single day than in any other day in American history in the United States. Al-Qaeda was responsible for that. Al-Qaeda will return to Afghanistan. It's already in Pakistan. It will return to Afghanistan once the United States, whether it's a year or two or three, leave. And we do not have the capacity to train and stand up an Afghan police or military, given the limitations that we have on our forces, our budget, and the time that the president wants to be there. But I would ask you the question, is it really training camps in Afghanistan that's the problem? Is the real problem a bunch of guys training hand-to-hand combat and using AK-47s? No. The problem was flight schools in the United States. That's what caused 9/11. And planning in Hamburg, Germany. So I'm not sure you can make the case that counterterrorism, trying to deny Al-Qaeda a base of operations in Afghanistan, is either doable. If we could do it at a reasonable cost, it might be worth it. But the question is, we can't. And that's why the president has wrapped a counterterrorism strategy within a counterinsurgency strategy, which requires reforming the Afghan government, training the Afghan police, purging corruption from the ministries, and ultimately standing up an Afghan army. Who's going to do that? We're going to do that? We're going to rebuild Afghanistan? Let me make a concluding comment about Iran and the Arab-Israeli conflict and then conclude with one additional observation. The same logic, I'm afraid, applies to Iran. Iran is a country with a profound sense of entitlement and insecurity. It wants a capacity to produce uranium indigenously. It's already got that capacity. It wants a breakout capacity for a weapon. States that are profoundly entitled and insecure want nuclear weapons. The North Koreans fall into that category, they got them. The Indians fall into that category, they got them. The Pakistanis fall into that category, they got them. You could even argue that the Israelis, to a certain degree, and their nuclear option was developed well before any of the others, also fall into that category. If Iran wants a nuclear weapon, and that's still an arguable proposition, the actual production of a weapon, as separate from the capacity to produce one, then I don't believe the United States is going to be able to stop it. That does not mean that the Israelis will not try, and I feel here that it's hard for me to believe that any Israeli prime minister will want to be remembered as the prime minister who allowed Iran to develop a weapon without a cost or consequence. And I've already heard the prime minister on this subject, Prime Minister Netanyahu. He's not going to allow Ahmadinejad and the Iranians to do to the Jews in 8 minutes what Hitler tried to do in 8 years. That is the trope. That is the mantra and the mindset of the Israelis on this issue. Can they stop Iran from developing a weapon? They could delay it for a year to three. That's our Secretary of Defense's assessment. So what that means is the lawn will have to be mowed every 2 years. The grass in this case is Iran's capacity to develop a weapon. Is that a sustainable situation? I don't think so. The Arab-Israeli issue. And please don't misunderstand. Distinguish between illusions and hope. No more illusions is my mantra, not no more hope. I have hope. But a reasonable man or woman looking at the situation between Arabs and Israelis today could only conclude one thing. The prospects of getting to a two-state solution of the Arab-Israeli conflict, which is the least bad solution, to borrow a phrase from Mark Twain or Ben Franklin, proximity breeds contempt and children. The Israelis and the Palestinians have a problem. They are living on top of one another. It is that proximity that really is the source of the issue. And unless they separate through negotiations into two states, which is the least bad outcome, the conflict will go on. I just do not see much of an opportunity for that. Let me conclude with one additional observation. I'm writing a book now, a new book called Can America Have Another Great President? It's a book about presidential greatness, what it means or what it meant, how come it hasn't existed since FDR, and what is the promise that it could ever return? The last president that had an impact on me was Jack Kennedy. I was 12 when he was murdered. Jack Kennedy said something about himself which is really quite wonderful, and I would leave this with you today because it's about all the optimism you're going to get out of me. Kennedy described himself as an idealist without illusion. An idealist without illusion. That's where America needs to be. Never abandoning the notion that the world can be made a better place. But as we go through it, trying to make it a better place, we need to go through it with our eyes wide open. Thank you very much.
Our thanks to Aaron David Miller, Middle East analyst and negotiator and author of the book, The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. It's time now for our audience question period, and we have a number of questions. One of them, I think this is a very good one, asks about Tom Friedman and his point in a recent column that perhaps the U.S. should walk away from the Arab-Israeli conflict until both sides are ready to negotiate themselves. This is the point you make, in a sense, in your book, that, and you've made it today as well, that they need to ready themselves without prompting from the U.S. and other.
Yeah,
other
Tom, people. I mean, I would, full disclosure here, Tom Friedman is a very close friend of mine. Tom also said that you can't win the lottery if you don't buy a ticket, so, which is also a very important piece of philosophical advice. Tom and I argued about this after the column. I don't agree with that. It's a variation. I work for Jim Baker. Tom was covering the State Department then, and Baker had this notion of the dead cat on the doorstep, that's how you get the Arabs and the Israelis to move. You blame them both by leaving the dead cat on the doorstep. I don't think that's going to fix the problem. And I think American withdrawal is not an option. Regardless of whether or not we think we can resolve this or whether or not it can be resolved, we have to stay in the game. We can't expose ourselves and demonstrate weakness by proposing peace plans that fail or going after the Israelis for a comprehensive settlements freeze or the Arabs for partial normalization or pushing the Palestinians to come back to the negotiating table and getting three no's from all of them and not saying or doing anything. I mean, that's bad for the great power. But withdrawing from the field, it seems to me, is not the way to go.
You mentioned the U.S. involvement in the Middle East historically. Next week, the Palestinians, in fact, this week, they're negotiating with the European Union and asking for their help. They're basically, in a sense, bypassing Washington and bypassing Israel. And this has caused yet another conflict, of course. Can you talk about that and how desperate, in a way, both sides really are?
Well, I think that part of the problem, and this is really sad, because this is a conflict in which good people are caught up in circumstances sometimes, I think, beyond their control. The Arabs and the Israelis are desperate, but the reality is they aren't desperate enough. They are prepared to absorb and inflict on one another unlimited amounts of pain. I mean, have you ever asked yourself the question, why, if the conflict is so bad, how come that the publics, how come that ordinary Israelis and Palestinians don't sense this desperation and this pain and create a sense of pressure on their respective governments in order to resolve it? And the answer is that they don't, because they somehow have this perverse way of ensuring that the conflict is bad, but it doesn't get to the point where it's completely out of control. The reality is, and every breakthrough in the Arab-Israeli conflict confirms this, that violence and insurgency in war, accompanied by the possibility of opportunity, pain plus gain, is what is required to shake Israelis and Palestinians and Arabs and Israelis loose. And we just, unfortunately, have had an enormous amount of pain in the last decade without much prospects of gain.
The Y Accords that you were partial to and were stuck in a sense, as a lot of negotiations are, on the question of Jerusalem. You've talked about that. A question from the audience is, what is the solution for Jerusalem? You write about the past in your book, The Much Too Promised Land. But is this one of these intractable problems that really will just never be solved?
No. The problem is the absence of political will, not the absence of clever diplomatic fixes. This has always been the case. And this is why when the breakthroughs have occurred, they've occurred when leaders are able, with some measure of vision, without sentimentality, to rise above their narrow political circumstances and think and act strategically. So you give me Israeli and Palestinian leaders who are not prisoners of their constituents, but masters, and you can solve all this, all of it. And that's the difference between abandoning hope, which is irresponsible and morally unacceptable. I have two kids, one's 29 and 26. I don't have the right to mortgage their future on any of these issues by surrendering to despair and cynicism. But there is a difference between maintaining hope and clinging to illusions. And this has got to stop. It's too costly. We have to see the world the way it is. And the way the world is now is that you have Benjamin Netanyahu and Mahmoud Abbas, clever politicians. They are unlikely capable of making the kinds of historic decisions on these existential issues, borders, Jerusalem, refugees, security. These are beyond their capacity, in my judgment, to achieve. And Barack Obama cannot compensate for the absence of their leadership with his own.
Speaking of such things, the question is, what advice would you have for President Obama regarding the Arab-Israeli peace process? I know one question that's come up certainly in the last several months has been the question of settlements and how much Washington pushes the Israelis, how much they push back, and whether, in a sense, that collapses the process. You mentioned Mahmoud Abbas. He's threatened to resign and so forth. And so there really is a sense, I think, that the Arab-Israeli peace process is really not, the peace is definitely absent and there's little hope for it to appear in the next short time.
I mean, I'd say I'm out of the advice-giving business, but I'm really not. But if I had my 5 minutes with the president, I would say, Mr. President, 3 a.m., 4 a.m., whenever you have your look in the mirror and you ask yourself the core questions, you ask yourself just two questions. Number one, how much do I really care about Arab-Israeli peace? And number two, how much am I prepared to risk in order to achieve it? If the answer to both questions are a lot, if that's how you answer both questions, then you're in the game. Then we can now talk about maybe how to create over time the kind of environment that might give you an opportunity to resolve it. But if you don't think it's important and you're playing at this and you're not prepared to risk by pushing everybody, not just the Israelis, but everybody, yes, you're going to have to push the Israelis because pushing the Israelis is an occupational reality in Arab-Israeli peacemaking. The only three Americans who ever achieved anything in the Arab-Israeli arena, I nominated them into the Peace Process Hall of Fame. I voted them in. They're there. I interviewed them all for my book, Henry Kissinger, Jimmy Carter, and Baker. All of them. Kissinger for his disengagement agreements, Carter for the peace treaty, Baker for Madrid. All of them wrestled with the Israelis. But you know, at the end of the day? At the end of the day, they succeeded. And the Arabs were better off for it. The Israelis were better off for it. America was better off for it. My point on settlements is, you want to fight with the Israelis? There'll be plenty of time to fight. But fight over something that is important. Don't fight over settlements. Fight over borders. Because if you can get the Israelis and the Palestinians to agree on borders, Then you can fix the settlement issue. Don't fight with Israelis on settlements as a piecemeal process. Go for the whole thing, the whole enchilada. So you don't have to negotiate three times with the Israelis, only once. That's the advice I would give him. And having pursued a policy which asks the Israelis for a comprehensive freeze, including natural growth, which no Israeli prime minister, even the most left of center, would ever have agreed to under an American ultimatum, he got a predictable no. And he got a second no from the Arab states. We're not going to normalize with the Israelis until they stop settlements, until you stand up. And he got a third no from the Palestinians. We're not going back to the negotiating table, Mr. President, until the Israelis stop settlements. So the president boxed himself in. It's now 11 months, year one. He boxed himself in. He achieved almost nothing on the Arab-Israeli issue in 11 months. It's hard. I'm not criticizing you, Mr. President. It's hard. But when the tiny tribes say no to the great power, and there's no cost, and there's no consequence, that doesn't make America or you. I mean, he's going to get this month, in Oslo, the Nobel Peace Prize. I guarantee you, the Europeans think they did a very clever thing, because it was a down payment for the president. 2 weeks after he was inaugurated, they decided to nominate him. 2 weeks. On what basis was Barack Obama nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize 2 weeks after he became president? The Europeans, clever, thought to themselves, we'll invest in this man. We'll give him the Nobel, because it'll be, hello, Barack Obama, goodbye, George W. Bush. That's what the Nobel was all about. I guarantee you, this guy is too smart not to think to himself, why did they do this? I've got this Nobel hanging around my neck now, and every day that I don't accomplish something, my opponents and adversaries, even my supporters, are going to think, well, he's got his Nobel. Parens, what for? Close parens. That's the problem.
A reminder for our radio audience, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Today we are speaking with Aaron David Miller, Middle East analyst and negotiator and author of the book, The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. Another question from the audience. In a book 2 years ago, you wrote that a point may come when the two-state solution is no longer possible, but we're not there yet. Are we there yet? And I know there are scholars who've come to the Commonwealth Club, Palestinians, who said that among Palestinians, they now are proposing a one-state solution.
Right. I don't make predictions, but I would make this prediction. Over the next 48 years, arguably the length of the 43rd president's tenure, Barack Obama, different president's tenure, the two-state solution will either come to fruition, or it will join what the previous administration on another issue called the dustbin of history. It's got a perishable date on it. It's not 2 weeks like a carton of milk, but we're looking at a finite period of time, because the facts on the ground, in conjunction with the facts up here, these facts of hopelessness, of despair, of the notion that negotiations don't work, of surrendering to the forces of history. The forces of history could talk to you tonight. Here's what they would say. They would say, don't listen to these diplomats and negotiators. The Arab-Israeli conflict can only have one outcome. There'll be one winner and there'll be one loser. That's what the forces of history, if they were able to speak, would tell you. That's a very bad outcome. A very, very bad outcome. But it's now more conceivable to me than ever before.
In your opinion, this is another question from the audience, in your opinion, why didn't the Camp David Accords result in success? And I know there's no easy answer to this. This is why people write books.
Right. 12 people were at Camp David, and you have at least five different books and different explanations. I'll give you mine, and if my colleagues were here, including the former president who led the American delegation, he would give you a different answer. There are three schools of thought on Camp David, and I'll summarize them for you. There's the Orthodox school, which is Barack made the best offer in the history of the Arab-Israeli conflict, wasn't good enough for Arafat, he went to violence. That explanation is the one that most Israelis, most American Jews, probably the president and many of my colleagues believe. Then there's the revisionist interpretation, which is, no, it's not that easy. Everybody screwed up. Had people's behaviors been different, Arafat's, Barak's, Clinton's, we would have had an agreement. Then there's my school. And I call my school the determinist school. There was never any chance or possibility in July of 2000 for a conflict-ending agreement between Ehud Barak and Yasser Arafat. Not a chance. And when the President of the United States went around the table during the second briefing and asked everyone whether or not he should go, everybody said the same thing. You should go, Mr. President, because if you don't go, there'll be violence. No one will ever understand why you withdrew from the field at a time and on an issue that you believed in. When he came to me, I had a decision to make, and I made the wrong decision, because I basically said what Madeleine Albright said, what John Podesta said, what Dennis Ross said, and I should have said, Mr. President, you're not going to like my answer, but here it is. There is no conflict ending agreement possible right now. Barak and Arafat are too suspicious of one another, too mistrustful. The gaps between the two sides are too large. You will not get an agreement at Camp David. That doesn't mean you shouldn't go, but you have to begin conditioning them and your own policy to begin to shape an outcome that is more acceptable than the loss of hope. I didn't say that. It was not one of my finer moments. And truth to power is a very important idea. Now, would my reclama have stopped Bill Clinton from going to Camp David? Absolutely not. Barack was pushing him to go. Clinton wanted to go. He had the dead Israeli Prime Minister Rabin on one shoulder, the dead King Hussein on the other, his own personal political problems were hovering over him. His legacy was there. It was a six-month clock ticking down on his presidency. He cared about this issue more than any other president. There was no way my reclama was going to dissuade him from going. But that doesn't matter. I was paid to give him my best advice. And I didn't. So there's a lot of blame to go around. But on this one, Tom is wrong. You can't win the lottery if you don't buy a ticket. Tom is absolutely right. But some tickets in life are just too expensive. And that was one of them.
It should be said that your book, The Much Too Promised Land, is a memoir as much as it is a description of history. And you do, as you've done just now, you do in the book, issue, maybe not mea culpas, but you look at yourself objectively and from a distance. And one of the things you write about in the book is that originally in your first years with the government, your nickname was Dr. No. And the nickname came about because you were often pessimistic about the chances for peace and other things. And that actually, in a way, you changed. And in fact, and I don't know if you received another nickname, but you really went the other way. And then in the book you say, well, I see now that life's diplomacy as well is a balance.
It's about maybe. Yeah, I was Dr. No because the circumstances didn't warrant any other response during the 80s. And then Jim Baker came along, the first Palestinian intifada, the first Gulf War. There was an opportunity. America was respected, was admired. The first Gulf War provided a moment when American power was respected. The last serious foreign policy we had in this country wasn't terribly imaginative, wasn't terribly creative, but it was very competent, and it worked. And if I'm right about success, that counts a lot. And that was Bush 41 with Baker. So under Baker, I became Dr. Yes. But see, in becoming Dr. Yes, you could end up being too much of a believer. And that's exactly what happened. So I write in the book that I'm now Dr. Maybe, which is, frankly, where I should have been all along. But if life isn't about learning, then what's the point? So, yeah, the book is not an I told you so, put it that way.
Right, and one of the things that one learns by reading the book is the fact that you were raised, you're Jewish, and that in the Middle East, in speaking to people, people made assumptions about you, sometimes comically, sometimes in other ways. I think you were asked if you were part of the Haagen-Dazs fortune at some point. But can you talk about, there's this old...
that was actually a funny story. Haagen-Dazs was started by Polish Jews. And one senior ranking Egyptian official one day out of the... I mean, there were all these views of many of Baker's advisors and Clinton's happened to be American Jews. And the myth that grew up here around us was extraordinary. Yeah, so Egyptian diplomat asked me if I was actually heir to the Haagen-Dazs fortune. Why he thought my family had anything to do with ice cream, I don't know. I mean, this is part of the what I call the other Arab-Israeli conflict. There are two Arab-Israeli conflicts. There are the ones that the Arabs and the Israelis fight, and then there's a second conflict, which goes on in the United States and in Europe, which is derivative of the first one, in which the supporters of the Arabs and the Israelis do battle. And they have their own demons and their own ghosts and their own boogeymen and women that they conjure up in order to explain why America is the way it is. But, yeah, I mean, it's really, really interesting. I'll tell you one story because it borders on, and I think I tell it in the book. When my mother died in 96 of cancer, I was in the middle of the Hebron negotiations. And obviously, I came home weeks before to be with her. But in the traditional ritual of Judaism, I said the Kaddish for her, and I did it every day for a year, which is the custom. Not because I'm a religious person, I'm not, but to honor her. And I'll never forget, it was in the middle of a negotiation. Mahmoud Abbas was leading the Palestinian delegation, and it was 15 minutes to midnight, and I had not done this very quick ritual prayer. So, out of respect for her, I leaned over to the American ambassador and I said, look, I gotta do this. I need 10 Jews in order to have a minion in order to pray. I mean, I'm on the borderline here. This is an official delegation and I'm asking you, out of respect for my mother, to stop the negotiation for 10 minutes so we can do this. So he said, absolutely. So the negotiation was stopped. Abu Mazen, the current president of the Palestinian Authority, and Mohammed Dahlan and the other members of the Palestinian delegation took a break, went over to the into the library, and watched as Israelis and Americans did this prayer, ritual prayer, for my mother. And I often thought about that, what the Palestinians were thinking. What did they see when they saw an American negotiator, an American diplomat, a Jew, interrupt a negotiation out of respect? And in talking to Abu Mazen, he said to me at one point, he said, you know, I misjudged you Americans. I never thought that this kind of religious identity or respect for prayer had any meaning for you. And now I have a different conception. So it was interesting. On balance, I'm glad I did it. I think an argument could be made that it was not appropriate given the circumstances, but you know, it is what it is, or it was what it was.
A reminder to our radio audience, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Today we're speaking with Aaron David Miller, Middle East analyst and negotiator and author of the book, The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. Another question from the audience. You say that the cost of nation-building counterinsurgency in Afghanistan is too great. What do you see happening if the strategy is not pursued, and which relates to another question from the audience about Pakistan and Afghanistan and the price that America has to pay there?
As I mentioned, we're in an investment trap. We're dealing with two countries who will be in conflict long after Barack Obama has left the White House. We have interests there. There's no question. I'm not arguing that we don't. The question is, how fundamental are they to our national security? The organizing principle of a nation's foreign policy is to protect your homeland. If you can't protect your homeland, you don't need a foreign policy. The president made that case at West Point. To him, Al-Qaeda is the threat. Decentralized, on the run, off balance, no attack in 9 years. All of that is true. And his view is we cannot allow Al-Qaeda to return to Afghanistan. Now, that means, and it all seems logical, but what that means is that it's not just counterterrorism. He has to create a counterinsurgency policy that defeats the Taliban, injects credibility and coherence into the Afghan government, trains 90,000 Afghan police and military. They want to bump those numbers up to 140,000 within 18 months. Within 18 months, if he's serious about the policy he's laid out, we will not be leaving Afghanistan in 18 months. We won't. Now, that's another reality. And if the numbers are right, $1 million for every American man and woman during the course of a year, and you're talking 30,000 forces, you're talking $30 billion a year. $30 billion a year. So I don't have an alternative. That's my problem. And I've struggled with this. I do not believe we can simply withdraw immediately. I would look for a glide path over the course of a 2 to 3 year period, because I think this is a trap. And more Americans will die. The president's calculation is you put Americans in harm's way now to prevent Americans from being in harm's way later. I'm not sure that I buy it, because I don't believe the key to our security in Washington, in New York, in San Francisco, in Los Angeles, is whether or not Al-Qaeda has training camps in the mountains of Afghanistan. Yes, that produced 9/11, but what produced 9/11 was a complete and utter failure on the part of law enforcement and American intelligence. Missed signals, lack of imagination. We know this now. It was flight schools that hurt us, not a bunch of guys running around with automatic weapons in Kandahar.
We're down to perhaps our last question. And Afghanistan, for those who've been in the area, Afghanistan, of course, is connected to Pakistan, but it also shares a border with Iran. And so if one is interested in the Middle East, one can't help but be interested in that part of the world, Central Asia, really. This question relates to Iran. The question is, this questioner says, Iran is not going to attack Israel today. Is the existential threat to Israel really political theater gone wrong?
You know, I know a lot of very smart people who argue that Iran is not a crazy state. The logic chain is this. Iran is not a crazy state. You do not acquire a nuclear weapon in order to use it unilaterally against the Israelis. You acquire it for prestige and for deterrence and to get attention, which is essentially what the North Koreans have done. And they've used it very adroitly. I live in Chevy Chase, Maryland, right on the borderline between Washington, D.C. and the state of Maryland. For me, this is not an existential reality. I don't think the problem is that Iran will attack Israel unilaterally. I think the problem with Iran's acquisition of a weapon is the other problem, which is I got to have one too. And that issue of a number of proliferators, because that is exactly what's going to happen. The Iranians will acquire a breakout capacity. The Israelis already have maybe 250 nuclear warheads. The Saudis will want one. The Syrian program will be accelerated. The Egyptian program will be accelerated. Everybody who's got money, access to technology, is going to want a weapon. That's the real problem, it seems to me, because that kind of proliferation does raise the not just the possibility, but under some circumstances, the probability of an actual exchange. The fact that in 60 years, only one country in the face of the earth has ever used nuclear weapons against another country, America, in August of 1945, on two discrete occasions, does not give me a lot of confidence that we can't see these weapons introduced somewhere else again. We don't know everything. We don't control everything. There is fortuna in life, stuff that just happens, like what happened here in October of last year. Things, bad things, Wall Street, the meltdown, the Great Recession. There's a lot of stuff that just happens, which we don't control, and this is a very serious piece of that stuff.
Our thanks to Aaron David Miller, Middle East analyst and negotiator and author of the book, The Much Too Promised Land, America's Elusive Search for Arab-Israeli Peace. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. I'm Jonathan Curiel, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned. Yes.